We have a new session today. I am pleased to start day two of the seventh ISN Educational Ambassadors Program in Africa, the Dikirnis project. And we have a new session today. I think it is the first of its kind that we invited expertise from all around the world with different culture and different age, different also background and training. All of them eminent professors of nephrology. We have two professors of nephrology from India and two eminent professors of nephrology, one from Brazil and one from Bolivia. Also, we have our eminent professor Intisar from Morocco, representing the Middle East. Also, I would like to welcome Professor Faisal Shaheen. He is the co-founder and the leader of the organ transplantation in Saudi Arabia, and also he is the president of the Organ Donation Society. Thank you very much for attending today. I know that it is still Eid holiday in Egypt, and it's very good that you are with us today. So I would like to announce that our eminent expertise is with us live, and I will start to share their opinion by now.
Greetings from India. I'm Dr. Urmila from Amrita Hospital, Faridabad, National Capital Region of. Greetings from India. I'm Dr. Urmila from Amrita Hospital, Faridabad, National Capital Region of India. Well, Dr. Ahmed wanted me to say something about certain suggestions and tips of being a successful nephrologist. I thought, am I the right person to be doing this? But then I realized Dr. Ahmed is a very intelligent nephrologist. So he must have seen something in my life or in my career to ask me to do this. So here I am. In the next 7 to 10 minutes, talking to you all about how to be a successful nephrologist. Please bear with me as I share my slides. So, in the next 7 to 10 minutes, I'll be discussing how to become a successful nephrologist. In the initial part, I discussed my early medical education, or for that matter, yours. You should always be careful as to why you choose nephrology. And the most important part is your nephrology training, which is the beginning of your career and is the foundation stone for your successful clinical life. And what are the components of your nephrology clinical career which will make you successful? And whatever you do, however successful you are, please pay forward, because it adds to your success. Now, in your early medical education, think very carefully as to why you want medicine. This profession should not happen accidentally, neither it should be an emotional choice. You should not be doing medicine because your parents wanted you to do it, or your father or mother was a physician. And if you have a choice, which most of us have, choose wisely the medical college you wish to train in. That medical college have give you a complete 360 degree exposure, and it will help you decide choosing your subspecialty. And during your medical training, initial medical training, get out of the training as much as you've given, because you all know how much hard work it is to be an intern or a junior resident. My early training was in Jipma, Pondicherry, where I did my MBBS. I did my MD internal medicine in Honorary Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, the premier institution of our country. And my subspecialty training was in Christian Medical College, Bellevue. During my time, these three institutions were the top three medical colleges in our country. And I was really privileged to get trained in these institutions not only learning medicine, but also rubbing shoulders with giants in the field. My mentors were all well known internationally, and they not only taught me nephrology, but they taught me many, many things which I wouldn't have learned anywhere outside. Then, when you are actually deciding on your subspecialty, you have to know why nephrology. And you all should always choose this subspecialty because you want to be a part of it and you see yourself doing justice to it. Nephrology is a specialty closest to internal medicine. In India, we call it the queen and slave of all medical specialties. It's also, nephrology training includes fluid, electrolytes, acid base, the smartest part of medical knowledge. Nephrology is integrated with immunology, infectious disease, oncology, critical care, and most of physiology, pharmacology, pathology, and biochemistry. So it's an interesting and a very, very challenging specialty. There are difficult parts of the specialty. There are long, unpredictable hours, and there are many chronic patients with multiple comorbidities for whom whatever you do, they don't just seem to get better. The beginning of your career, clinical career, actually starts with your nephrology practice. Your clinical nephrology training is where you set your foundation stone for your clinical practice. Learn everything that you get, the opportunity that provides to you during this 5 years of your fellowship. Your objective during this period is to grasp all aspects of the specialty. And you should also, amongst all these 5-6 subdivisions, decide your area of interest during this training period itself, so that you can focus on that area a little more. And you should be very clear that this area is where you see yourself as an opinion leader in the future. As a successful nephrologist, always has same role models. They are teachers, mentors who guide you throughout your career. These are people who have made a deep impact in your profession and your career. These are teachers you look upon when you have difficult decisions to make, either they are clinical, ethical, or moral. And for me, I was extremely privileged to have Professor Jayashim Sastri as my role model, my professor in Christian Medical College fellow, who was a tiring figure in Indian nephrology. And then there was Professor Vidya Acharya, the first woman nephrologist in our country, who has been a pioneer in many, many ways. Never forget the people who have come before you and who have made nephrology as it is. Always remember that you are what you are because of them. The essentials of a successful nephrology practice is that you always keep your patient first. Your clinical practice will define you, and so maintain strong ethics and a rigid moral compass. Interact with your colleagues whenever you've got an opportunity. You learn from them and the patient benefits. Interact with your cardiologist, your pulmonologist, with your gastroenterologist. Learn a lot of things, of nuances of medicine. Important to know how much money you make, what car you drive is not important in your success. But involve yourself in trials, collaborate, publish, teach whenever you can. Dr. Ahmed is a part of the International Society of Nephrology social media team. And he, like many of us, often uses the social media to teach nephrology across the world. Do something beyond the ordinary. Keep abreast, learn new skills. In our time, there was no focus, no interventional nephrology. We are all learning it as a part of your career. This apparatus which you see is the microscope, which is in my office. This is something I think all of you as successful nephrologists do. Interpret your pathology slides. Go beyond the ordinary, take clinically complex cases, never hesitate to involve them. The first picture shows a lung transplant, a pediatric lung transplant on ECMO and on CRRT. These are difficult. You may be afraid, you may be anxious, you may be apprehensive, but never, never hesitate to take care of these patients. Many times in your career, you will be called upon to take care of celebrities. Never be worried about that. I had the privilege of taking care of this gentleman who was one of India's greatest film stars for about 9 to 10 years. I learned a lot from him. And always pay forward. I feel as a part of success in my life, is the ability to take care of poor and vulnerable patients. I am privileged to be part of an NGO in Bangalore where we take care of type 1 diabetic children. And this, I think, is a measure of a success for all physicians, to be able to take care of people. Pay forward in many other things, look and never neglect professional inequities. Help underserved, underprivileged colleagues, colleagues with professional constraints. And we are privileged, I am privileged to be the founding member of Women in Nephrology India, which has now got international recognition. Please understand your success multiplies if you are involved in others' success. Finally, don't get disheartened. There are many obstacles, many mistakes, many failures in this path. If Dr. Ahmed asks me to talk about my mistakes, I'm sure 10 minutes will not be enough. So please go through all difficulties, persevere, learn, study, sacrifice, and most of all, love nephrology. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. I want to thank first Dr. Ahmed Ad for the invitation to record this video. And I think he is doing an amazing job in inspiring younger generations of nephrologists and moving forward nephrology in Africa. Well, my name is Rolando Claure del Granado. I am an internal medicine doctor and a nephrologist working in Cochabamba, Bolivia, here in South America. I have done my medical school here in my city at Universidad del Valle. Then I moved to do my internal medicine residency and a nephrology fellowship program in Mexico City at Instituto Nacional de Ciencias Médicas y Nutrición, Salvador Subirán. For a year, I worked in private practice there in Mexico City, and that allowed me to apply during that year for a ISN nephrology fellowship program, which I have done at the University of California, San Diego, in the area of critical care nephrology and AKI, being Ravi Mehta, my mentor there. Actually, I am in charge of the AKI and continuous renal replacement therapies in my institution. I work as a nephrologist at Hospital Obrero Número 2 in Cochabamba, Bolivia. And I also involved in many ISN activities. I am part of the executive committee. I'm also involved with a mentorship program in the ISN, with a fellowship program, with a social media team, and with the Emerging Leaders program. And I am also involved with the Latin American Society of Nephrology and Hypertension, that's called SLAN, where I am part of the AKI committee. I have been the past president of the Bolivian Society of the Nephrology and past head of the nephrology division of my institution, which I already told you is Hospital Obrero Número 2 here in Cochabamba, Bolivia. Well, what are the things that could make your career successful in nephrology? I think one of the key aspects is to find inspirational figures during your career, and that begins when you're a medical student. I could mention that my first inspirational figure was my father, who is also an internal medicine doctor and a nephrologist, who introduced me to this amazing specialty that is nephrology. I also remember that when I was in my fourth year of the medical school, he brought back from a from a Latin American Congress, a book about AKI, recent advances in AKI. And I got caught with this disease, and that's why I devoted my career, my research career, to AKI. I have another inspirational figures in my medical school, that would be my, for example, my immunology and rheumatology professor, and my professor in pharmacology. And during my internship, that for us is the sixth year of medical school, which you spend the whole year doing rotations at a hospital. The physician at the ICU, Dr. Ramos, inspired me a lot about doing research and exploring more things in critical care. After that, during your residency, my residency, sorry, and my fellowship, I also find inspirational figures. And I could mention my the director of my program, that was Ricardo Correa Rotter in Mexico City. He inspired me in the sense that I saw him, how he was traveling around the world, giving lectures, being part of the executive committee of the ISN also. I said, well, okay, I love that, and I want to achieve that, and I want to help moving nephrology forward everywhere, especially in low and low middle income countries. I think one other key aspect is that you have to take every opportunity that goes through your path. For me, ISN was a tremendous opportunity to boost my career, and the fellowship program is an amazing opportunity for nephrologists like us that come from low and low middle income countries to explore new things, connect with people, establish networks, etc. And from after finishing my fellowship and doing a small research program, that path and achieving new things was very interested and improved my whole career, as I already told you. I think now my goal is to inspire new generations, show them that even though you are coming from a low or a low middle income country, things can be done, things can be changed. You can have an impact by doing research and by improving your clinical service, starting with your hospital, your local center, then growing to inspire and achieve more things at regional level and then lower level. I think so many things are feasible, but you have to be very motivated, take the opportunities you have, look the support from your fellows, from your mentors, and I guess that will help you a lot in achieving many, many, many things through your career. Well, that's what I have to tell you. I hope that these few words and my history in nephrology could help you to achieve greater things in your career. And as I always said to my mentees, dream bigger. You could do amazing things in your career. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I am honored and delighted to take part in this valuable ISN educational ambassadors activity, to which I was invited to give advice to young nephrologists to lead successful careers. I am a Moroccan nephrologist, and part of what I do is train young fellows to become nephrologists. Well, the very first advice I would give and focus on is be passionate. You should feel the passion for what you do, feel the satisfaction for helping others via delivering care. This is the first anchor a physician, I mean any physician, especially a nephrologist, should have in order to be successful and achieve fulfillment, both personal and professional fulfillment. Because it ain't easy. Strive out there in our specialty. It's hard, it's challenging. And most CKD patients do have plenty of comorbidities, and they are very, very demanding. Therefore, the most important thing you can give them beside medication are your time and your attention. And I guess that it's impossible to be a nephrologist if you lack passion and empathy. Second advice, inside the specialty, try to find your field of interest, your niche of practice. I mean, that niche is suitable for you, that you enjoy most. This could be CKD and clinical nephrology, dialysis, peritoneal dialysis, hemodialysis, or kidney transplants. And by doing so, you're in fact choosing and selecting your area of practice, be it public health, private sector, or university medicine. Register and attend ISN webinars. There are plenty of them out there, and they're quite practical. Benefit from fellowship programs and take part to the various ISN programs that do target young nephrologists and empower them. And locally, try with other young nephrologists from your county, for example, to gather and implement local young nephrologist committees. They are very, very interesting. Send your work and participate to the various events, and don't miss the opportunity to discuss it with experts at these meetings. It's a good way to broaden your vision on your daily practice, and it is truly enriching. Networking is important too. Reaching out to colleagues via modern social networks and modern communication technologies is very, very interesting and enriching through forums or specialized platforms, just like the ones provided by the ISN or the EDTA. This enables you to learn about the challenges and share experiences with other young nephrologists from around the world. Be active. Get involved in activities that serve your community. This way you can reach disadvantaged populations in your area, be useful to them, be relevant in your actions, and by raising awareness about kidney disease in your area and country. And this is, by the way, very rewarding and gratifying on so many levels. Seek mentors in your team first, of course, then role models and experts beyond your team. And always remember to work hard in the direction of your dreams, of your goals, and to learn as much as you can. Last but not least, needless to say, to persevere, to never give up, and to remain thirsty. This is very important. Remain thirsty for knowledge, thirsty for improvement, and always keep in mind that no goal is out of reach, and that your world is only as big as you make it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'm Augusto Santos Jr., a nephrologist based in Brazil and currently the ISN Education Social Media Deputy Chair. I'm very pleased with this opportunity to address young nephrologists, mainly because during my professional career, I participated as a young nephrologist of several different medical educational programs. This provided me the chance to benefit not only from training programs of excellence, but also to understand the importance of integrating different populations with different priorities and beliefs in order to build more sustainable global integrated healthcare systems. Healthcare is facing a new era, revolutionizing the way we make diagnoses, deliver care, and treatments. Much of this revolution was already on the way, but was further accelerated by the COVID-19 pandemic. Telehealth, sensors, artificial intelligence, big data are just some examples of technologies that are transforming the healthcare sector. And in this scenario, if I had to choose a medical specialty, I would definitely choose nephrology. Nephrology is a field full of opportunities to young professionals. Innovation based on science is transforming how we deliver care to patients with kidney disease. In addition, the International Society of Nephrology provides a full range of opportunities to young nephrologists. Just to cite some, there are travel grants, fellowships, mentorships, and of course, several social media networking opportunities and online educational activities. Much of my current work is focused on fostering critical thinking, reducing the impact of misinformation in our society. I have been involved with health and technology assessment, innovation, disinvestment from low-value healthcare technologies, and patient involvement in medical decision. Acknowledging the diversity and putting into action a plan to reduce inequalities has become one of my main focus. Therefore, my course is about developing healthcare models capable to relocate the patient to the center of the driving force of innovation and making healthcare systems more human. And it's in this regard that I would like to leave to you a final message. If you're watching this video, it's because we have some things in common. One of those things that we share is our passion to nephrology. I would like you to think on what is your purpose? What makes you get out of bed? What does success look to you on a daily basis? And by starting with your why, I would like you to plan what will you do in the next 10 years of your career to get to your objectives. And in this expedition, I would like you to understand that you are not alone. Count on the International Society of Nephrology and count on your peers to help you in this journey. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. This is Dr. Mangisha Yadla, Professor Head of Children Nephrology, Gandhi Medical College, Department of Nephrology, speaking from India. I congratulate everyone for becoming a nephrology trainee and who have expressed their interest in pursuing the nephrology course and who are also inducted into the ISN education program. It's not easy for you to get into such a program. So first of all, congratulations to every one of you who want to see the heights of the nephrology, who want to deliver the nephrology services at the best in your parts of the world. So what I would like to say at the outset is that I want to thank Dr. Hemant for giving me this opportunity to speak to all the youngsters who are getting included in this program. All the best to everyone. The tips that I would like to give you based on my experience that I've been at for the last 15 years is that please focus on the epidemiology of nephrology, because the local area problems are definitely specific to your own area. The global problems as well as the local problems. The global problems are most commonly the non-communicable diseases, which anyway you will learn over a bit of time. The local diseases which are going to affect your own areas where you reside are the ones which need a little focus. So multiple local areas, if they're focused at in delivering these services, I'm sure the global kidney care is also going to improve. So what I mean to say, please get to know about the problems that are prevalent globally as well as locally. Coming to the patient as such, please focus on the patient, especially taking their history, a little on examination so that you arrive at the particular diagnosis. Do not very far away from the definitive diagnosis. As you all know, the investigations form the crux of our management. Just not the investigations, but focus on history as well, which develops a rapport of yours with the patient. And I remind you that nephrology is one particular, one such specialty where you will have a long rapport with the patient, because patients either they undergo the renal replacement therapy or they undergo transplant, they are with you forever. So please develop a good rapport, maintain a good clinical practice, methodologies, so that the rapport is a healthy rapport and then you benefit out of it as well as the patient. Having said about the clinical services and epidemiological services, I would like to put a focus on the research services. So being inducted into the program, I think it's time that you also focus on the research, because research is less done in our subspecialty. So a chance given to you at any point of time in your future course, please focus on the research, especially as I emphasize local problems. Highlighting the local problems on a global platform or international platform is going to fetch you a good experience, as well as addressing the problems which may have a solution with the help of the international platforms. And in addition, please, as being a student, focus on certain media as well as social media, which are in fact crucial for you to get updated. Updation of your knowledge apart from the textbooks is also going to happen to the media. Attending the webinars conducted by the International Society of Nephrology, checking in the ISN Academy, which is available in the International Society of Nephrology website, and becoming a member of ISN is extremely crucial for you to utilize all these opportunities. Not only this, but then there are certain other social media as well, like YouTube and Twitter, wherein regularly the case-based discussions as well as the journals are being discussed, which in fact is a treasure of knowledge for you to keep yourself abreast with the developing science and expanding nephrology field. So at the end, what I would like to say is that please focus on the patient who is right in front of you, taking the history and a little examination as well as investigations, develop a rapport with the patient, counsel the patient, be a part of their decision making, help them in taking the correct decision so that they move forward, and also early detection from epidemiological perspective, and little research, whatever you can, local research which can go to a global extent, and be keeping yourself abreast with the scientific knowledge, to the journals, e-journals, to the media and social media is definitely a priority for you when you are in the education program. Thank you so much, and all the very best to all of you. May you reach the success of glory in your nephrology field, in your respective areas. All the very best.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank all our expertise, and also now I would like to ask all our expertise with us online to join us. Please, Dr. Manjoa, Dr. Professor Ormella, and all of our colleagues, Professor Faisal, Professor Usama, Dr. Ahmed, please open your mic, and I think it is a very good opportunity, excellent opportunity to start a discussion with our young colleague and to answer some of their question, and also it will be an opportunity to solidify the informations, a lot of informations already given to them. I'm searching for our other colleagues, if they are joining, Augusto, Ronaldo. If not, I think we will go forward. For our attendees who want to ask us a question, please raise your hand and I will open the mic for you so you can ask us directly. And until you all are ready with questions, I would like to start the questions. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Ormella and Professor Manjoa for their excellent presentation, as well Professor Intisar, Professor Ronaldo, and Professor Augusto. And it got to my mind a very interesting word that came with Professor Ormella, that the nephrologist is the queen and the slave of other specialities, which is really true. And every day we feel this, we feel sometimes that we are the king, and we suffer a lot of times that other specialities sometimes abuse our service. So what do you think about this, Professor Manjoa, the Professor Ormella words?
Yeah, good evening, Dr. Ahmed. Thank you so much for inviting us. It's in fact a great opportunity for us to speak to everyone out here. So we had tried to, all of us had tried to give certain tips with respect to the practice patterns or practicing the nephrology, because you're going to become a nephrologist in future. So you need to focus, you need to learn certain things from us, as well as you need to learn certain things, focus on certain things during your practice. Incidentally, Dr. Ahmed, I would like to apprise you, today in our culture happens to be a teacher's day in our culture. So I think it's the apt time that we are sitting here trying to give certain tips to the students. So all the speakers have raised very pertinent points, like, I mean, the how the focus should be, how they should be trained, and the ups and downs during the course, which should not dishearten. So nephrology, of course, as Dr. Urmila has said, is prevalent everywhere. In fact, you cannot, it's like drawing a line in the sand when you speak about the internal medicine and nephrology, because nephrology is part of internal medicine. So wherever internal medicine is there, nephrologist has to be there. All our problems are embedded in internal medicine. So the best nephrologist will always be best in internal medicine and also best in critical care. So knowing the subject is one aspect to be a good practitioner, but just not that. Having a hearing ear to the patient and caregiver is equally important. Pay certain attention. Ours is a department wherein, in similar lines to oncology, we need to pay a little more time in counseling. It's just not like cardiology or rheumatology, wherein we just overcome in just few minutes counseling. Ours is going to be a time-taking counseling. In fact, few setups will have certain medical social counselors, but then if you don't have, do not worry, you should be the one. In fact, when patient hears a problem from you, patient hears a counseling from you, that will be much more heartening than the disheartening problem. Yeah, than the disheartening problem they have. So telling him the disease itself is a big thing, because there'll be denial from the patients, because it's going to be almost always a chronic kidney disease. So everybody will be afraid from the society, that listening to that itself will be like a dread thing to them, threatening them. So counseling them is very, very important. And as I said, develop a good healthy rapport with the patient, because follow-up of this particular group, whether it is acute kidney injury, whether it's nephrotic syndrome, whether it's a chronic kidney disease, whether it's a transplant, whether it's a dialysis or either types, we need a good rapport with the patient. Patient needs to have trust in us, and we need to have trust in the patient. So that mutual rapport is very, very important in nephrology. Having said that, I think not just the points that have been raised, but ethics and legal, these are the other salient issues when you go out in your practice. So you have to be ethical in your practice. You should know your legal practice patterns in your country and follow it accordingly. And ethics remain probably globally neutral everywhere and common everywhere. But then the legal aspects of it differ between the countries. So know your legal practice patterns, know your ethical practice patterns, pay a lending ear, hearing ear to the patient. And of course, you should be good in your nephrology subject. Having the textbooks, I needn't tell. I think the standard textbooks are very, very crucial for us. And of course, the social media. I am active on social media. I'm also secretary of Women in Nephrology India. We are very active on social media as well. We learn a lot by interacting with everyone on this media, which is available, platforms which are available. And I am in charge of everyday case nephrology, which I discuss once in a month with the people.
Yeah, it's true. You are one of the leaders of
on
the case.
Yeah, doctor.
Discussions. And now I will take the words from Professor Faisal.
And, thank you
very much. Thank you. And I will take some words from Professor Faisal, and I will go back to Armella. Professor Faisal, to our nephrologist from outside the Middle East, he's one of the eminent professor in the Middle East. Is not only a professor, but he is a creative. He's co-founder of many of the basic services of the Middle East. He's very supportive. He initiated the transplantation program in Saudi Arabia and many other countries and in the Gulf. He is the president of so many societies, I cannot remember. And also he's a professor since I entered the field, but I don't want to give him a very old age, but he is high in the caliber more than the age. Please, Professor Faisal, give us your opinion. Thank you.
Thank you, Ahmed. And actually, I am very happy to be one of the colleagues learning from you and others, because we return back to the basics, and we have to return back to our, once we start our nephrology career. I started my nephrology career, it is long time back, as you mentioned, since 1981 or something. It's very long history. But I admire the work that we, the nephrologists know everything about other diseases. And usually the project in a very high caliber, because he can understand cardiology, he can treat cardiology patient, he can treat hypertension, one of his work, internal medicine, he can, he have enough knowledge about all other specialty, because the nephrologist is probably different. As you mentioned also, they put over the shoulder of the nephrologist many other things, which he can tackle in a professional way, and this is why he is in a high caliber. The other important thing is that the nephrologists stick to their patient till one of them die, either the physician himself or the patient died. So one of the things that 80% of your patient, they will stuck with you till the end of their life or your life. So we know that every day you are taking more to your family. Patient become like a family member. You will see him for his life, all his life. So put this in your mind that every day you see a new patient coming to nephrology, he stuck to you, and he will be your friend, your brother, and deal with him like this. This is my advice. Thank you very much, Ahmed. And it is excellent speaker and excellent I enjoy every single minute I can see the
thank here. You very much, Professor Faisal. Now we are with Professor Ormella, and I will start the discussion with you. It's very important sentence you give us about the background of the training and the value of the teachers in our life. From my experience, I am very developed with by observing my teachers, actually. And I remember my first day in the hospital and my first day in the field of internal medicine and nephrology. And they advised me to go to Professor Sobhi, who was the chief of our service and a very big name. I know him since I was a student. So I was very scared when I'm knocking his door to meet him as a new resident. And he just told me, what is your name? Why you are here? I am the new resident, so come with me. He took me to downstairs to the library, and he pointed to a very small handbook and told me start with this one. And he left the hospital for something else. He was going to the college. So I was surprised all of this. This is all the advice that I will start my career. But later I remember that he's giving me all. He showed me the library and gave me the start to be small and then go big. And believe me, I already read most of the books in our library. Same experience I saw in Oxford when I went for MD. Same behavior from my professor, Catherine Wood, there. It was the same. So I was not surprised. This is the matter of self-learning and the leaders. So I would like to take the discussion to another site. A question came from one of our colleagues in the audience. His name is Abdelhamid. He was asking yesterday about the value of the guidelines. Why we have guidelines and how much we should stick to the guidelines in view that we are talking about individualized medicine. So each patient should have his own approach and his own medicine, and also the delay in the guideline release. So we have maybe 1 year, 2 years, according to the society and the kind of guidelines. So what is your opinion about this new approaches in medicine, the guidelines, the hospital policies, and all of this? How you manage to work with all these regulations, and what the young should do about this? Thank you.
Ahmed, congratulations to this wonderful meeting. It's, as you said, a new of its kind, and you've given a platform to many of us to talk about these aspects of nephrology, and I congratulate your participants. I see quite a few numbers there. It's midnight here in India now, but your enthusiasm really kept us awake. Now, it's a very important issue that you have brought up, that how should a nephrologist approach, as you said, when we were students, self-learning, just getting inspired by your professors, learning from your patients, to this era where practicing nephrology has become part driven by guidelines and instructions and, you know, various other forms of mechanisms by which we are told how to treat patients. I think each one is as important as the other. I will learn from my patients. I will learn from my mistakes, and I will continue to treat my patients. But I will also be guided by the guidelines, but not be completely obsessed by them. Because guidelines are predominantly Western philosophies, and most of the patient guidelines that are written by experiences of teachers or professors or scientists who are working in a different area. You and I come from a different ethnicity. Our diseases are different. Our environment is different. Our clinical structure is different. Our finances, our socioeconomics, all are different. So I think we should amalgamate both, but at the end of it, use our wisdom to take care of patients and do what is absolutely right, feasible, and the best option for our patients in our setting. Thank you, Ahmed. Thank you very much. And I wish you all the very best for your meeting.
Thank you very much. And I would like to ask the audience if anyone having a question, I can open the mic now. Otherwise, we will go forward for the next session. So, thank you very much. I would like to, we have Dr. Gamal, so I will unmute you. Please, Dr. Gamal, accept and unmute yourself.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for this presentation.
First and, of all, let me introduce you, Dr. Jamal.
Dr. Jamal
from Libya.
Dr. Jamal Idrissi from Libya, doctor in nephrology center and master of physiology.
Okay, go ahead, Dr. Jamal.
Thank you for this wonderful conference. And just I want to ask Dr. Majnosha about the number of dialysis patients in India, because India is the largest country in numbers of people. Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Jamal, thank you. Thank you for that question. I have posted the answer in the group, but having asked a question, there is no definite registry as such for the hemodialysis patients in India, but an estimate says that it's about 1,75,000, which I still feel is a little underestimate, but giving a prevalence of around 1.9 per million population. So this is a highly prevalent, the numbers are very high as you have anticipated it to be, but then accurate number is yet to be known. This is an estimate that we have as of 2018. Dr. Jamal.
Okay, thank you very much. We have also Dr. Najwa. Please unmute yourself to ask the question.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmed. Thank you for this wonderful course. I ask a question. I want to ask how to form a transplantation center. We have a new college at SOAS, as you know. We prepare to make a new center for transplantation. What is the preparation?
Oh, this strategy? Is a very important question. Actually, we have a session for Professor Faisal to tell us how to set up a successful program for transplantation. This will be on Wednesday. Thursday 21, and it is on the schedule. So Professor Faisal will talk in detail from his own experience. He already initiated a lot of transplant centers. In his session, he will please be with us, and he will talk in detail about this important issue. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Now, Dr. Mohammed, please unmute yourself and ask the question. So no one now is, no one want to ask any further questions. So I will go ahead with Dr. Osama. Next session, Dr. Osama, are you with us? Do you want to add any information, Dr. Ahmed?
Thank you, our prof. There is great lectures and great information, and the arrangement of this arrangement is very, very, really difficult. So I would like to thank our dear Prof. Dr. Ahmed. And we need to more concentration on items which is done in our field in Egypt, in more simple rules.
Like what, Dr. Ahmed, what do you mean? By focusing on symbol.
Like hemodialysis and experience in other parts outside Egypt, what we can do more than to more professors in Egypt.
Okay. Dr. Osama?
Thank you, Prof. Ahmed. This very great presentations. Happy to be with you, with all the team, and sharing experience with different cultures and different people. It's very important to every one of us. Everything is fine, I think. No, I have no comment, no more than that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So now I will go forward. We have a very important lecture from Dr. Osama about CRRT.
I It is my great pleasure to join the seventh ambassador program for ISN in Africa with Prof. Ahmed Aal, which has a great contribution on the ground in Egypt and Africa. Thank you, Prof. Ahmed, for the great effort you are doing in this program. I will talk today about the CRRT, about definition, indication, when to start, what modality, how can we do the procedure, and some of the complication of this procedure. When we face a case of acute kidney injury, according to Rifle, we have to stage it. If we have a stage one, so we have a risk of more severe AQI monitoring to prevent the prognosis. If we have a stage two, so we have a risk of acute kidney injury related mortality and morbidity is high. So we need to start a conservative management. But if in case of a stage three, we have a high risk of this, so we consider CRRT, our renal replacement therapy. About the case, how can we face it? We need to follow these procedures. Discontinue only for toxic medication and the agent, ensure the volume status and the perfusion pressure. So we consider the functional hemodynamic monitoring, like if we are using CAs or ARBs, we have to stop it temporarily until the case will be stabilized. Avoid hyperglycemia by controlling the blood sugar by IV infusion of insulin, and to consider alternative to a 4 ready contrast process, and not use non-invasive diagnostic workup. If not sufficient, we can move to the invasive diagnostic workup and check for changes in the drug dosing, which is very important point. We have to check the GFR every then and now, and to adjust the drugs according to it. If the patient developed stage three, so we consider to shift him to ICU. If we need access, I will mention the details. But the most important point, try to avoid subclavian clusters. To start, so we need to first to know what is the indication of renal replacement therapy in AKI. First, bind the renal indication, which includes the life-threatening indication like hyperkalemia, if serum potassium more than 6 with ECG changes, and if the metabolic alkalosis is there with pH less than 7.15, of in case of pulmonary edema, which is resisting to diuresis, and in uremic complication like the uremic pericarditis or the uremic encephalosis. But we need to stress on the non-renal indication, like fluid removal in congestive heart failure and the fluid management in multi-organ failure, or cytokine manipulation in sepsis, or treatment of drug overdose and mutual support. Actually, the non-renal indication is wide range, but I will not break it in detail to the sake of the time of this presentation. So when to start? This review have 11 studies. These 11 studies are included in different design, like retrospective and controlled trials and observational one, and different type of different number of population in the study. To differentiate between early and late, it divided among the UN, serum creatinine, urine output, and to use the conventional type of CRRT. In the end of this review, 10 of the 11 studies there prefer to start early than late in CRRT. So the early intervention with renal replacement therapy in AKI, either by conventional type or CRRT, has better survival than the late start. So what modalities we have in CRRT? We have actually 4 modalities: the peritoneal dialysis, intermittent hemodialysis, low efficiency hemodialysis, and the CRRT, the continuous renal therapy. The CRRT itself has 4 divisions, or has 4 categories. The SCAF, the slow continuous ultrafiltration, continuous veno-venous hemofiltration, continuous veno-venous hemodialysis, and the continuous veno-venous hemodiafiltration. So let us go to the BD. So BD is sufficient, yes, but has some advantage and disadvantage. What is the advantage of BD in AKI? Hemodynamic stability, slow in correction, easy access to place, No anticoagulation needed and tolerated in the children. So what is the disadvantage? Less risk of infection, difficult to use with abdominal surgeries and the logistics. But it means that the fluid may be not available or there is no experienced personnel to use the BD in the centers. Is the high volume peritoneal dialysis is indicated or effective in the acute kidney injury? The answer in this study that concludes that the high volume peritoneal dialysis is effective for selected AKI patient group, allowing adequate metabolic and fluid control. And if we notice this figure, that the high volume by using 3 liters in each cycle for each cycle 1 hour, it will be effective in hypercatabolic patient using the BD in hypercatabolic patient. Another technique, the flow through peritoneal dialysis, applying flow through to the BD patient would require 2 catheters or double lumen catheter, and to obtain optimal clearance, the dialysate should be pumped through the peritoneal cavity at high flow rate. If we use the continuous flow peritoneal dialysis, we can use even in different technique. By using the continuous flow like this, or continuous intermittent flow by CABD, or continuous cycular BD, even we can use tidal BD by maintaining BD fluid in the abdomen about 1 liter, or can be used, or can add to it 1 or 2 liter in the abdominal cavity in each cycle. Let us go to the definition of CRRT. It is an extracorporeal blood purification therapy intended to substitute for impaired renal function over an extended period of time and applied or aimed to being applied for extended time, 24 hours to 72 hours. We have different types of the machine of CRRT worldwide. So what is the modalities of CRRT? Let's get concentrate in this slide. We use high flux dialyzer. The high flux dialyzer can be used by diffusion and convection. By diffusion, if we use dialysate, so we use the dialysate to have dialysis, it will remove the small molecules. But if we use the convention technique by high flux dialyzer, it will remove the middle molecules and the small molecules, and also it will need replacement fluid. So we have diffusion if we use dialysis, we have convection and replacement fluid, so we have a hemofiltration. So if we continuous venous hemofiltration, we use convection, but in continuous venous hemodialysis, we'll use diffusion, and the continuous venous hemodiafiltration we use the convection and diffusion, but in SCUF we use ultrafiltration for fluid removal only. So in diffusion, the membrane will have the semimembrane membrane, which allow to pass the fluid through the membrane from high concentrate to low concentrate. And in diffusion, we use dialysate, and it will pass only in small molecules. But in convection, we will use the replacement fluid, and it will use the high flux dialyzer, which has more wide pores, which allow to pass the small and the middle molecules, and we use it as a stress on it, the replacement fluid. But in absorption, we have a special type of filter, which can be used to absorb the materials, but it has limitation that the full capacity, which can extend the capacity of the filter, which can be used. Very important point, we need to know that the size of the small and the middle and the large molecule and substance, that we need to know that the substance, what the molecular weight, to decide what technique we'll use. If it's a small size, we can use a diffusion. If it is middle molecules, we can use a convection, which you can move the small and the middle molecules. So the membrane with small pores can will move only the small molecules, and if it is middle molecules, it can move to the small and the middle molecules in the same pipe. Let us go the principle of CRRP clearance. CRRP clearance of the solute is depend on the following: the molecular size of the solute, the pore size of the semipermeable membrane. One of the major principles of the clearance of CRRT, the higher the ultrafiltration rate, the greater the solute clearance. Also, one of the principles is small molecules easy pass through the membrane driven by diffusion and convection. In middle and large molecules already cleared by convection, a semipermeable membrane removes solute with the molecular weight up to 50,000 Dalton. But in the plasma protein or substances highly protein bound will not be cleared. I thought about the safety convenient. Safety convenient is the ability of substance to pass through the membrane from the blood component of the hemofilter to the fluid component. The safety convenient of one, it means allow the free passage of the substance, but the safety convenient of zero substance is unable to pass. So zero convenient of one, it allow pass freely, like potassium or creatinine, it pass freely. But of zero, like albumin, it will not pass through the hemofilter we are using. Let us go about some advantages of CRRT. One of the major advantages of CRRT is the hemodynamic stability of the patient. It means what? If we want to remove 4 liters of CVH about over 24 hours, it means that it can pass, it can move, this fluid without over the extended hour with not a major effect on the main arterial pressure. As we notice, the arterial pressure is not effective. But if we move the 3.5, which is less than the other side, in 4 hours, we notice the sharp drawdown of the fluid removal and the effect of the mean arterial pressure, which can cause more fault of the blood pressure and more ATM due to the fault of the blood pressure. So the guidelines suggesting that we use CRRT rather than standard intermittent renal replacement therapy for hemodynamic unstable patient, which is a gold standard. If the patient has low blood pressure in inotropes, it is better to use CRRT rather than conventional type. But in the other side, CRRT and the conventional type are complementary, not are competitive. What is the meaning of this? If we start the CRRT for hemodynamic unstable patient and later the blood pressure improve, so we can shift to the conventional type of hemodialysis. And the other side, if the conventional type was started with the blood pressure was stable in the start and the blood pressure drop after this, we can shift to CRRT. So the two processes are complementary, not competitive. What about the recovery of the acute kidney injury? Is any mortality has advantage? Let us go to this review. This review has 6 studies. In these 6 studies, if we notice that the modality is intermittent, like this, the 3 types, we notice the survival about 67%, 59%, and 65%. But if we use a CRRT, it is more than 90%, 90%, 92%, and 89%. So the recovery is better in CRRT rather than conventional type. Another point. The role of CRRT in management of increasing intracranial pressure. We need in this situation to fold the serum osmolality slowly, not rapidly. Which is the fold of serum osmolality is rapid in conventional type and slow in CVH. So CVH is preferred. According to the guidelines, we suggest using CRRT rather than intermittent renal replacement therapy for the AKI patient with acute brain injury, or the other causes of increased intracranial pressure or generalized brain edema. Another point about the removal of cytokines by the special filter we are using in CRRT, yes, it can remove, but it has limitation. Only it can remove within the first hour of the use of the circuit. But is CRRT by this time, if the machines is available for all the center, answer, of course, no. But if we don't have this type of CRRT, what can we do? So we can use another technique, which is known as SLED, low efficiency dialysis. Typically performed over 6 to 12 hours, can be performed with conventional dialysis machine, has little less labor intensive and require less training and start up procedures, and have some advantages like the flexibility, reducing cost, low or absent anticoagulation, and it has similar adequacy and hemodynamics. We'll need to show to you some studies to show it is similar or not. There's one small study about 16 patients shows slightly that the SLED is slightly higher acidosis and lower blood pressure. But in the VA trial, it suggests a similar outcome of CRRT and the conventional type, especially in SLED type. If we want to start, what's our requirement to start this procedure? We need a central double lumen caster, venous hemodialysis caster, extracorporeal circuit and hemofilter, a blood pump and effluent pump, with a specific CRT technique, dialysate and replacement fluid are required, solution, anticoagulation, and we need to decide how much dose we will use. About the vascular access. The guidelines suggested initiation of renal replacement therapy with patient with AKI via uncuffed and tunnel dialysis caster rather than the tunnel caster. So, but what is the place of the insertion? The first place we need to insert the right RG vein. Second choice, the femoral vein. Third choice, left ventricular vein. Last choice, subclavian with the referred for the dominant side. Not only this, we need to stress on is the vascular access in CRRT is very efficient, is very important. Because if the vascular access is poor or has any problems, it will have frequent clotting of the circuit. So we need to stress in this point that the site of the caster of the insert, it is very important. So if we need to insert in the right IG line, we need 15 centimeter French caster. If we need to insert in the left IG caster, we need to insert 20 centimeter French. If we need to insert in the femoral line, we need to have 25 centimeter French. What about the replacement flow? The physician need to adjust based on the clinical need. We need to use a sterile replacement solution, maybe bicarbonate based or lactate based. Must be high electrolyte we need, must be sterile and delivered for IV use, higher rate increased conviction, convective clearance, and the physician, you need to know what he will use. One of the main points that we use lactate or the bicarbonate, this study has comparison between the use of lactate and bicarbonate-based solution. And the results which show that the serum lactate concentrate was significantly higher and the bicarbonate was lower in patients treated with lactate solution. This increased lactate solution had effective in the cardiovascular stability and need more anatomic support to have the maintain the blood pressure and increase and give electronic support and can cause more dropping on the blood pressure of the patient. So the KDK guidelines were suggesting use bicarbonate rather than lactate as buffer dialysate in the replacement fluid in the replacement therapy of patient with AKI, especially in the liver failure patient and with patient who has severe lactic acidosis or lactic acidemia. About dialysate. Dialysate, as I mentioned before many times, it will use through the diffusion process. Dialysate correct the underlying metabolic problems. Dialysate is dependent on buffering agent, electrolyte, and the glucose. Dialysate formula should reflect the normal plasma values to achieve the normal hemostasis. let us go to the membrane. We need to use the biocompatible membrane, high flux membrane, which can act by the due diffusion, by two mechanisms, diffusion for the low molecular weight toxins and the convection for the large molecular toxins. And the category lines were suggesting using the laser with biocompatible membrane for either the unconventional type or CRRT type using in the acute kidney injury. The membrane has hemofilter composed of high flux material and synthetic biocompatible material, as a structural design characterized by high fluid removal and the molecular weight cutoff of removal 30 to 50,000 daltons. About the anticoagulation. Anticoagulation is one of the main issues. As I mentioned, like the vascular axis can be used with high experience in the CRRT. We can use the unfractionated heparin by good anti, which can cause good anticoagulation, which can cause thrombocytopenia and bleeding. Low molecular weight has low thrombocytopenia and bleeding. Citrate has lower risk of bleeding. Molecular alkalosis and molecular citrate has low risk of bleeding, but has metabolic alkalosis and hypercalcemia and has special dialysis, and it is good experience to use it in this circle. Regional heparin, to use heparin and the protamine sulfate in combination in NHG site, but it's complex management. Saline flushes has no bleeding risk but had bore efficiency. Prostacycline had reduced bleeding but high potency bore has bore efficiency. The key guidelines for the anticoagulation, for the anticoagulation for intermittent renal replacement therapy, we recommended as using either unfractionated or low molecular weight heparin rather than other anticoagulation. But in CRRT, the preferred anticoagulation is a regional citrate. As I mentioned before, we have to notice that it can cause regional metabolic alkalosis and can cause severe hypocalcemia. So we need to correct the hypocalcemia in the same time. Last point, how much fluid do we release as replacement fluid? In this study, about 420 patients who had zero arms. The first arm, about 146 patients used 20 milliliter per hour kilogram per kilogram. The other one was 39 patients using 35 milliliter per hour per kilogram. The third arm, 140 assigned patient, with using 45 milliliter per kilogram per hour. So the survival in 41, the first arm in the 41%. And which used the 20 milliliter, and the second arm, the 57% in the use 35 milliliter per hour, and the third arm, 58% will use the 45 milliliter per kilogram per hour. So when you 35 has significant survival than the 20, but when we use the 45 has no significant. So the initiation can be started by 35 to have better survival. If we have patient 70 kilogram, we can use the replacement fluid about 2.5 liter per patient per hour to improve our survival. Another trial, the renal replacement fluid study, which used about 1,500 patient, clinical patient, using an AKI, using continuous venous hemofiltration, using 25 milliliter one arm, about 700, more than 700 patients, or 40 milliliter per kilogram, and about also more than 660 patients, the results would in this study, there is no difference between the arm using 25 and the arm using 40 milliliter per hour. So the dose of the renal replacement therapy must be checked if then now, so we have to check the difference, is there any difference between the prescribed dose and the delivered dose, and we must write the delivered dose and the prescribed dose to be compatible for the need of the patient, and we need to follow up this every day and now during the procedure. This is my conclusion of this study. CRRT is a modality of a choice for hemodynamically unstable patient who needs renal replacement therapy. The current trend to provide renal replacement therapy earlier in AKI there is many recovery advance of using CRT rather than conventional type for initial management of AKI, but no difference on mortality. CRT has many non-renal indications which must be considered in management our patient. It does optimal intensive CRT is controversial, as I mentioned, as a study I mentioned. The lytic support of CRT needs individualization. It means every case we need to prescribe its own prescription according to the situation of the patient and according to the lab results of their. So we need to have a plan for FG patient to have higher mortality, to avoid the higher mortality and the morbidity, and we have need to have leaders and a teamwork for every process. Of course, we have a great success for our procedures, and thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Osama, for this elegant lecture. I will go forward to the next one, because the plasmapheresis is more or less related to the same subject. So please allow me to go to the next one. So I will talk about the plasmapheresis. Most of you, I know that you are familiar with the plasmapheresis, but also we have different young doctors from different locations, and not all of them are expert in all of the nephrology techniques. So we have to cover this. Also, I need to acknowledge that we have also, for the first time in our training, we have medical students from three different medical programs, one from Manchester, from Mansoura University, and one from Faqih Jeddah. So that's why we sometimes speak so basic. So all our young residents and clinical years of medical students can understand what we are talking about, besides the advanced ones. From history, plasmapheresis is very old. It goes down to the pharaonic era, and it was first documented in Edwin Papirius. But the term plasmapheresis derived partly from the Greek word apheresis, which means taking away or removal. It is unclear exact time of the this therapeutic initiation, but it was flourishing even before Hippocrates in the 5th century BC. Bloodletting to remove evil, as was a common place medical practice, partially because of the lack of understanding of the disease process and the paucity of effective therapy. And until now, as you know, we have hijama. Hijama in the Arab world and the Middle East is still one of the therapies, and they have their own society, and they are under regulation now, and it is still done in many countries. This is the evolution through the time of the plasma therapy. Since 1902, washing and the return of blood from uremic patient, and then we have a lagging of time to 44, frequent plasma separation, it was possible, and the plasma required during the war. That's why technology evolved. In 52, manual plasmapheresis first used in a therapeutic manner, and in after 10 years or more than 10 years, in 65, first continuous flow separator been developed and to remove the buffy coat. Then in 70s, start to use plasma exchange for Goodbusher syndrome, and in the 80s, plasmapheresis programs for routine collection of blood products. In 90s, treatment of plasma component, and in 2000, improvement in whole blood technology to replace some plasma treatment. As you can see, we are waving between the clinic and the lab. Sometimes it is go to the clinic immediately to treat some emergent or urgent cases, and then it is developed again in the lab to for better separation of blood products. So as we are talking about separation of blood products, we can also apply apheresis to separate different blood components in certain diseases, like in thrombo, in erythrocytosis, we can remove the RBCs, and in sickle cell disease also we can remove the RBCs. In malaria, we can remove and replace the RBCs with new healthy ones. In leukemias, we can use it during we are using cell therapies. In thrombocytosis, we can use it to remove platelets above certain limit, and we can use it to remove plasma, which is the focus of our talk today. The removal of plasma, the plasma contain a lot of components that can be abnormal and can be removed by plasma pheresis, including removal of antibodies like in TTB, Guillain-Barré, Myasthenia gravis, Goodbusher syndrome, cryoglobulinemia, immune complex like in lupus, severe lupus, removal of excessive or abnormal substance like paraproteinemia, cholesterol and hypercholesterolemia, removal of toxins, protein-bound drugs, toxins, mushrooms. Actually, I like this slide very much because it summarizes all what I need to say today. You need to know why you are doing plasma pheresis, not just it is written in the book, because you know it is written in the book and we have ongoing studies. We have published studies comparing plasma pheresis with other approaches. Many studies show that plasma pheresis has no significant role in anything. You can use cyclophosphamide, you can use immune suppression, you can use pulse, and compare it with plasma pheresis in many studies. I am sure many of you can write now a lot of studies that can show plasma pheresis has no significance. Plasma pheresis is a very expensive technique, and it is very difficult to have the replacement fluid, as Dr. Osama was talking about fluid. Now we need a plasma for a replacement. But if you know why you are using plasma pheresis through this slide, it is very beneficial and life-saving technique. And I know many professors even participated or contributed in publishing a lot of research showing plasma pheresis has no significance. At one time, they write by themselves in their prescription plasma pheresis for their patients because it is, at that time, it is indicated. This summarizes what I was talking about. We have a lot of sophisticated techniques for different separation of different components of the blood and for different therapeutic approaches. And we will talk in brief about each one of those ones. So simply, we remove blood from the patient as if we are doing dialysis, but we don't have a dialysate. We are not exchanging the blood with any other fluid. It is just a filter with big holes. It is bigger in size, larger in size than the holes, the bores for the hemodialysis. It is called a plasma filter, especially for separation of the plasma proteins. So when the blood go entering the filter, it will filtrate the plasma. So you need to replace this plasma, because you may remove 1 liter, 2 liters. If you just remove the plasma, it will end with severe hypotension and your patient will die because it is a very rapid process. So you need to calculate how much actually you need to remove, and I will show you how later on. And you give same amount of the removed plasma replaced with fresh plasma. So we are giving plasma to the patient, and we are removing the other plasma containing either antibodies, toxins, or whatever we want to remove. Of course, we are talking about protein-bound toxins. So here also in this figure, you can show that small molecules or creatinine, BUN, or equivalent toxins can be removed easily by using diffusion, using the technique of hemodialysis, which depends on diffusion. Just minutes ago, Professor Osama gave you a hint about this one. going to other larger molecules like vitamin B12, beta-2 microglobulin, and even kappa light chain. This called the middle molecule that it can be removed with another technique. It's called the convection, the hemofiltration. And here the larger molecules like the lambda light chain, albumin, IgG, IgM can also can be removed by plasmapheresis. This is the guidelines on from the American Society of Apheresis of its use of the therapeutic apheresis in the clinical backgrounds based on clinical studies. We have four different categories. Category one, it is disorders for which apheresis is accepted as first-line therapy, either as a primary standalone therapy treatment or in conjunction with other modes of treatment. Class two, disorders for which apheresis accepted as a second line, so it is not a first line, either as a standalone treatment or in conjunction with other modes of treatment. So if you notice that plasmapheresis is not a standalone therapy except in category one, it is always augmenting the therapy. In the stage or category three, optimum role of apheresis therapy is not established well. Decision making should be individualized for each patient. While category four disorders in which published evidence demonstrates or suggests apheresis to be ineffective or even harmful. So in this condition, IRB approval is desirable if apheresis treatment is undertaken in these circumstances. For whom not familiar with IRB, IRB, it means Institution Review Board. Each hospital, we have IRB board. It is Institution Review Board. It is different specialties, consultant from all the specialties of the hospital, including a lawyer, including an ethical and quality control specialist and experts. All can study the case and give their approval for this condition case by case. So category four, when you see category four for a certain disease, you need to have this multidisciplinary meeting, or if you have IRB in your institution, you ask for IRB approval before you prescribe your plasmapheresis. Otherwise, it will be an ethical issue for you. I will show you a list of different examples of diseases, and I will start with the category one. Category one, like acute inflammatory demyelinating polyradiculoneuropathy, which I mean Guillain-Barré. Guillain-Barré, it is category one. So if you face a case of Guillain-Barré, please prescribe plasmapheresis as a standalone therapy with no fear. You don't need to take opinion of any other institutions. In amyloidosis, amyloidosis, it depends. If it is beta-2 microglobulin, it is category two. So it is after the first line of therapy. While in other causes than dialysis-related amyloidosis, it is class four, you need IRB approval. So it is only the dialysis-related amyloidosis that you can, after a failure of the first line or to augment the first line, to do plasmapheresis. Also, in anti-glomerular basement membrane disease, Zygod-Basher, it is category one. And in the diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, while it is category three in dialysis dependent conditions. It is also category one catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome, either with lupus or without lupus. Also chronic inflammatory demyelinating disease. If you go one by one like this, you will find your way when and when not to prescribe plasmapheresis. I will take the last one, hereditary hemochromatosis in erythrocytopheresis. So mainly we focus on removing the RBCs, and it is category one. Also in hyperviscosity and in hypergammaglobulinemia, it is category one. In IgA, it is category three. So you need to incrementic and chronic progressive diseases. So it augment the primary therapy, and you can also wait for a decision individualized. How we do plasmapheresis? We adjust our machine. We have two types of the main two types of plasma filters. We have a plasma dialyzer that I will show you later. The hollow fiber can be used on the dialysis machines, and we have the centrifugation. But we adjust the blood flow at a low level, 60 to 100 ml per minute. That equal removal of 20 to 30 ml plasma per minute. It is very important to know the rate of plasma, because you are infusing in the same time a replacement plasma. If you remove in a larger speed, you are not happy. I know we always happy that we will finish early, but we will finish also the patient early. He will not survive and we will not be happy at the end. And Dr. Osama, as he is the director of syndicate, he will have a talk with us after this. So please don't make a very high speed of your machine. It is very slow technique. And even if you can go less than 60, please do to be less than this level. And if you need to do it fast, you'll be sure that you have a central line, because if you have even a big cannula, you will not have this rate, 20 to 30 minute ml per minute. Enough through a cannula. You need a central line. So you need a central line before you start plasmapheresis. As you can see, double human femoral or subclavian catheter, or a needle more than 18 gauge in the brachial vein. Anticoagulation, either citrate or heparin. We prefer citrates more than heparin, because we are using calcium as a replacement, which will antidote the citrate effect. It is 2 ampoules, 1 gram calcium gluconate, which is equal to 990 elemental calcium. Treatment volume, we have this equation. If we are using equivalent to plasma volume, we use the following equation: body weight multiplied by 1 over 13 by 1 minus hematocrit over 100. If you use this equation, it will give you the plasma volume. We have two different conditions and the preparation for the plasma. Either we use humanized plasma, so we ask for blood donors. Many donors can come and donate blood, and we can separate plasma from their blood, prepare the volume required, and we give it to the patient. While if we don't have this option, and in certain diseases, we are obliged to not to use fresh frozen plasma, but we need to use a human albumin. So how to prepare the human albumin? We need to know that we have 5% human albumin and 20% human albumin. In case we have 20% human albumin, we prepare our 2 liters of plasma like this, 2 bags of saline and 2 bags of dextrose, 5%. Each bag is 500. We remove fluid 100 from the bag of the fluid, and we bought 120% human albumin, which equal to 2 gram of human albumin. So at the end, we bought 2 gram of human albumin, or 100 ml of 20% human albumin, which equal to 100 ml volume, and 400 either saline 0.9%, dextrose 5%. And we prepare our 2 liters for our syrup. What is the techniques of apheresis? I already told you we can remove different components of the blood. We also have a different approaches to do this. We have a centrifugal device. We have a hollow fiber plasma filter. We have immune adsorbent column, and we have plasma component separators. Starting with centrifugation, it is more common in hematology department, because you know they have the machine in their lab. They are the one who separate the blood components from the donors. And also they can carry on the machine and go to beside the patient and do it. And I will show you an examples from the urology nephrology center. Continuous, it is continuous or intermittent. Citrate anticoagulation. The other way to do it, and this is preferable for a nephrologist, that we use hollow fiber. But for this centrifugation, it is more common in hematology department, the membrane, hollow fiber, more common nephrology department, and also discontinuous or intermittent, and using heparin as anticoagulation. So for the centrifugal devices, it allow, this is the machine, and this is the machine we used in urology nephrology center. We are removing blood from the patient and go to fill a container here in the centrifuge machine. And this container will run in at high speed centrifugation. So the plasma will go out from the centrifugation filter and be collected in this bag. It is very nice machine in donation. We use it for donation. As you know, if you use in the hollow fiber, we need the bags ready for replacement. And also here, we need the bag replacement ready. But if you ask for the plasma ferrites in your blood bank, they will ask you for donors. So each plasma bag, 200 ml, can be separated from one donor. You can imagine you need like 9 bags or 10 bags of plasma. So you will need a bus full of donors coming from the city of this patient. And you know, you will need more than one session. It is from 3 to 5 and sometimes more than this if in case of transplant rejection and in certain diseases with rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. So how come you will collect all of these donors that can reach to 50, 70 donors to treat your patient? This machine, it allow you to separate 9 bags from only one donor. You give him only fluid and he can do one session without hypotension. The machine is separating only the plasma. So it can separate from 500 to 900 from only one donor, and he also can be have good hydration, have monitoring of the serum albumin. He good have a very good diet of high protein diet for 10 days, and he can come back. You check for the serum albumin. If it is normal again, he can donate again. But only one session can cost you only one donor. So very important machine in donation, more than in the technique itself, but also we did separate plasma by using this machine. All modern centrifugation machines have a therapeutic mode, so it can be used for donation, can be used also for therapeutic plasma ferrites. From my opinion, it was very successful to use it for this patient. So there is no upper limit to molecular weight or protein removal. Blood flow rate, as I told you, can be slow and can reach up to 150 because this machine use a technique that it filled a container, do the centrifugation and returning back the blood and then taking a new blood again. It is different than dialysis. Dialysis machine, the blood is always in continuous manner. It's taken from the patient, removing fluid, going back to the patient. But here we have a halt of time inside this container. That's why they are using citrate. It is more powerful than heparin, otherwise it will be clotted. And they use calcium to remove the citrate later on. As we told you, you need a central line to do this, or a big needle umbilical vein. Platelet count should be can be decreased by as much as 50% during the technique. And this through patients from the urology nephrology center and both adult and pediatric also we can use. And you can see here, this is the plasma prepared from a diluted albumin, human albumin. And this is the patient removed plasma. And of course, this is a patient if you don't recognize him. And this is the adult patient as well. The other way to do it, we all familiar with this. It is a membrane, looks like the dialyzer, but it is written on it. It is plasma, have membrane bores of 0.2 to 0.5. All immunoglobulins will cross the membrane, IgG more efficient than IgM. Large immune complexes and cryo may not be adequately cleared. Many membranes allow clearance of molecules up to 3 million Daltons, and there is no loss of platelet. Otherwise, the centrifugation, there is an issue with the platelets. Here, we don't have any issue with removing the platelets. Hemolysis can occur if transmembrane pressure are too high. Membranes used in plasma filters are polysulfone, polypropylene, cellulose diacetate, polymethyl, metacrylate, or polyacrylonitrile. And we have a session dedicated to Dr. Karim that he will talk in detail about the different membranes. So this is a technique in a simplified manner. We remove blood from the patient. It go into the plasma filter, removing the plasma of the patient. And then while it is going back to the patient, we have a replacement solution at the same rate of removal and at ending with the same volume. So the patient will not have fluid overload or hyperproteinemia or hypoproteinemia or hypovolemia. The third technique is protein A immune adsorption. It is augmenting the plasma ferrites to remove immunoglobulins from the plasma. Protein A selectively binds the FC domain of immunoglobulin molecules. Immune adsorption column can be regenerated again. A column can be used for 1 year for a single patient on up to 30 occasions, but of course not in Egypt because we are not allowing recycling. Play a key pathogenic role in place of plasma exchange in Goodbusher disease, rheumatoid arthritis, removal anti-ABO or anti-HLA antibodies in highly sensitized transplant recipients. And of course, if you are only targeting removal of immunoglobulins, this will be very important as you will not need replacement of plasma. Mainly, you are removing the protein A immune adsorption through the column and giving back the plasma to the patient. This is immune A protein A adsorption for IgG, and it is a combination between plasma ferrites to remove the plasma ferrites, and it go to through the protein A column and recollected, removing the IgG, and the remaining cleared plasma go back to the patients. So you save the patient plasma, removing only the hazard immune globulin. And this is the difference between plasma exchange. We remove all the plasma and we need to replace, while here it is a small volume of waste in containing the immunoglobulins, and of course, a very little amount of plasma needed to replace this amount removed. More efficient. We have also the double filtration plasma ferrites, a membrane filtration to separate cells from plasma, and then secondary plasma filtration to remove plasma solutes based on molecular size. Most albumin is returned to the patient together with lower molecular weight proteins. So here we can also remove certain hazard cells through this double filtration. As you know, in COVID era pandemic, there were a lot of discussions, a lot of interventions, a lot of use of either injecting plasma to block the antibodies, immune complexes regenerated by the COVID-19 virus, or even using plasma ferrites. Many reported success and many did not report the same. So in here, it is the recovery study from Oxford. They are showing that convalescent plasma and also plasma ferrites in patient admitted to hospital with COVID-19 in a randomized controlled open labeled platform trial did not show any improvement in survival or other pre-specific clinical outcomes. Going back to the double filtration, this means that we do the filtration, we remove whatever waste we want, and giving the patient back the amount we need. We have new membranes coming, emerging, hemophenix technology for nanofiltration. As you know, we have two main issues with plasma ferrites. the issue of removing the plasma, we need to give the patient plasma and remove only the component of interest, like immunoglobulins, RBCs, whatever you want, but not all the plasma all together. And also the vascular access, not all patients like to have a central line and feasible to have a central line. You need to use a small cannula or an ordinary cannula. So they have this new membranes with bore diameter of 20 nanometers, and they have a new machine, hemophenix nano filtration based. It uses blood plasma filtration at a rate of 100 up to 50 to 100 ml per minute, but it can use an ordinary cannula. So the advantage allow performing the treatment with single and small needle with reduced extracorporeal volume, 70 ml, and you can put the machine bedside beside the patient. Low priming, short duration of treatment, exchange of low volume allows not to use plasma as a replacement fluid, so reduce the risk of infection and allergy as well. Can be comparable or even superior to traditional plasma apheresis as it is more tolerable and less invasive. After that, we have as dedicated machines, new technology only for plasma apheresis as these two examples. At the end, early introduction of plasma exchange appears to be effective for various immunologic kidney diseases. However, plasma exchange primarily serves as an adjunctive to other immune suppressive therapies and is often expected to have beneficial role. Early diagnosis and the treatment of the underlying condition and also knowing what you are actually targeting to remove remains the most important issue. And thank you very much. So now I think we are in time, exactly in time. And if any of you want to have a question, we have maybe 5 to 10 minutes. So go ahead, Dr. Gamal, I will unmute you. Give me a minute. It does not allow me to unmute you, but I will try.
Hello? Yes, doctor?
We are hearing you. Go ahead, ask.
Are you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. I will ask Dr. Osama, my friend, and also like my father, and I will be very happy when I meet you in Egypt. And
thank you, Gamal.
I want to ask about how I can determine the time of the CRRT, about the time session or also the number of hours of CRRT. And the second question, I want to ask about the new option if used in Egypt, because in Libya I have a new machine for use option of the stica or citrate calcium with the sodium citrate for some cases have a risk of bleeding. And thank you.
Thank you very much.
For the first question about the time of the CRRT, the expected time of every session from 24 hours to 72 hours. The maximum time for the filter of the CRRT is 72 hours. We monitor the electrolyte and the case of the patient, as I mentioned, if the hemodynamics become stable for the patient and the patient can tolerate the conventional type, and it is useful to it, you can shift to do the conventional type. Because the CRRT is very expensive therapy, okay? So we can shift from the CRRT to conventional type if the hemodynamics is stable. And if this patient is still unstable and the electrolytes still need, and the hemostasis still needs CRRT, we continue on CRRT, and the maximum time for the decision is 7 to 2 hours, because the capacity of the filter itself. So we can reset new filter and the new for the machine, and they can start new session for it. This is the first one. About the second question about the citrate. Actually, myself, I have no experience with citrate, but even in Egypt, I don't think so that we are familiar to use the citrate anticoagulation in CRRT. But citrate is very complicated therapy in CRRT, and as I said in the lecture, the presentation, it needs high experience. Why? Because the citrate itself can cause two major problems. The first of it, the severe hypocalcemia, so you need to replace IV calcium in the same time. Second thing, you have to titrate the dose of the serum of the citrate according to the metabolic alkalosis it will be having. All of this need more experience. But myself, I told you that I have no experience with it in the CRRT, and I think in Egypt, it's not familiar to use it in the CRRT. Thank you, Dr. Gamal. Nice to always to see you.
Thank you, Dr. Osama. And I would like to ask Professor Faisal if you want to add or comment on these questions.
Thank you. It's nothing to be added. Actually, the experience of anticoagulants during either blood nephrosis or different from one place to another place. I am sure that some people get used to have some way of anticoagulation, and they continue to do it, and they became experienced. There is no need to change. What we need at the end, that we don't need clotting in the system. So I agree with both of you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Faisal. And we have a colleague, Hana, asking if we can arrange a practical training on CRRT machine. It will be a great experience. I agree with you. Actually, I'm doing every year a CRRT workshop dedicated to physicians and nurses as well. And we have a new approach actually from Professor Faisal in Saudi Arabia that he encouraged us, and his encouragement did a breakthrough. That we used to have our nephrology nurses is taking care of all nephrology machines, including CRRT. But when he joined us, he told me it is not a correct way that you ask the dialysis nurse to come and sit beside the patient all the day, 3 days, doing shifts from our nurses. And the patient is a critical care patient. It is already undertake of the intensive care nurse. So why not we train the intensive care nurse, especially they are already trained on their CV to use such a machine. And why not they take over all the responsibilities and taking over all the machine. It took us about more than 1 year to train all the nurses of intensive care, with a lot of burden on us, me, Professor Faisal, a lot of phones, a lot of even we work as a physicians, technicians, sometimes nurses, we go and we fix the machine until they all are trained now. Actually, the establishment of the CRRT, it was rapidly developed after they start to take over and become well-trained on it with less complications, with more successful. And we are preparing a publication that will be in the upcoming months, comparing our start of the CRRT with the dialysis nurses. And after the ICU nurses become trained, we have a significant difference in the outcome of the patient as regards the complications and even mortality and the termination of the CRRT. So any of our colleagues want to ask? Actually, we are complimenting you about yesterday. We did not open any board for discussion, so we are opening now, waiting for you. Any other questions before we end? So, Dr. Nagwa, please
actually
start.
I want, I'm Dr. Sara from Shaqiya. I want to thank doctors and all the staff of lectures and professors about the lectures. And yesterday there was a very good lecture about the counseling the patient and talking with the patient. And then I think 70 or more than 80% of our problems in the units will be solved if we are dealing with patients in the way described in the lecture. It was a very interesting and important lecture to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sara. Actually, we need to talk with the patient and even to develop the clinical decision together with the patient. That doesn't mean that he is guiding our prescription or therapy, but rather than we are making him to participate because he has the right to know the different options in front of him and also the benefit and risk. And even we are in Saudi Arabia and Faqih, this is our routine practice and it is monitored by the hospital. And believe me, when your patient know whatever will happen to him and all the risks, including mortality, he will be more comfortable and more dedicated to your therapy and he will follow your therapy more. And we are taking decisions critical, like starting dialysis and so on. Sometimes we are referring our patient to the critical care unit because of pulmonary edema, we need to start fast. When you explain all of this to the patient, and if he is not conscious enough to take the decision to his family, actually they understand very well what you are doing and appreciating as well.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Please, Dr. Najwa,
tafadhal. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you, Dr. for your excellent lectures. Thank you all. I am asking MCRRT. Dr. Osama said that we can use complementary between CRRT and conventional hemodialysis. In this way, can we change the filter for the CRRT how often? Because this is expensive equipment.
The question you are talking about, yes, using the dialysis machine as a CRRT machine. Is it correct?
No, doctor. We are using the patient on CRRT machine and the patient is stable now and we can shift him to the dialysis. So conventional hemodialysis. So can we throw the filter and the lines which are so expensive or we can still the patient on the CRRT for 72 hours?
I understand now. So he's hemodynamically stable and he's fit to start the interventional conventional the dialysis, but you still have time for the initially prescribed the CRRT. You may have 1 day more. So I will leave the floor to Dr. Osama to comment on this one.
Yes, Tura Sara, you know, it depends on the type of the machine you are using.
Yes.
Like in PrismaFlex, like the one of Gambro or Hospital, no, the kit is separate. The kit is one set. The lines with the filter is one set built on one side to the machine. So no way to change the filter. Or you have to change all the circuit. But in multi-filtrate for Fresenius example, you can change the filter if the filter is colloded before the lines is okay. So it depends on the machine you are using. And you know the most expensive thing in the circuit of the CRRT is the filter itself. The filter is very expensive. And one of the major problems for CRRT is frequent clotting. So you need to know what is the problem, why frequent clotting is happening to the machine. Actually, the presentation I did is 25 minutes only. no, there is many sophisticated things there in this CRRT, but slow circulation, it is slow circulation. You need to know the axis itself. The replacement you are using is pre-filter or post-filter. If frequent clotting is there, you need to use the replacement fluid is pre-filter to dilute the blood and decrease the use. The other point, always our experience with CRRTs used to use unfractionated heparin with the follow-up with BTT. Okay, so yes. You need to have the proper dose of heparin or anticoagulation you are using. It is not you need to change the filter like this. No, you have to know the use, why the filter is corroded, and to solve your problem.
Okay, thank you, doctor. Thank you very much.
I wanted to also add one sentence. If your patient is hemodynamically stable and he is already the expenses of the session is already paid, or you don't care about the expenses of the session because it is already prescribed, and you know it is not only the filter and the lines, but also the fluids. Fluids is so expensive, and the more time you will use, you will use more fluid. So if you can support the fluid for the end of the prescription, and your patient is still unclear if he will be maintaining the stability or not. For example, he's just weaned from IV vasopressors in the morning in the ICU. They are planning to extubate him. Later they will plan for a radiology with injection of contrast or any other conditions that may burden the patient. So I would like to continue the therapy. Otherwise, if he's already renal failure coming with heart failure and you already used the SCUF technique or you used the HDF and he's recovering and no need to continue, you will discontinue yourself. And
thank you.
The opinion of Professor Faisal on this issue.
I was working with Prof. Faisal Shaheen in Jeddah Kidney Center from 1993 to 1995. Actually, he was good in a small machine. Shaheen machine. Yes, this is very important issue. I have to mention it. Why I'm mentioning it? He used a SCUF by the pump of dialysis machine. It's very simple technique. We can use it by our own what we have. We don't use to have the CRRT machine. He used his own machine in 1993, Shaheen machine. I need his comment for this.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Actually, he reminded me, we have Shaheen SCUF HD.
Yes.
And this is being already in editor in Athens at that time, I present my experience to initiate this machine for the poor country. And it is very simple machine. I use one pump, and it was out of this pump, I can dialyze the patient. It was excellent. Excellent, and whatever I need from the patient, I did. So I did the dialysis. I did the dialysis for the patient by a very simple, very cheap machine. And also, I have to mention here there is something more, which is the hospital machine actually creative also from the two things which I did. The two things which I did also combined two machines together, and out of this machine, someone from the company hospital saw this combination, and out of this, he said, "I will create what's known as Brisma machine now." So the initiative of the thought about the machine or Brisma machine started, in King Fahd Hostel in Jeddah. I'm very proud to know this and to see this prisma in practice. So anyhow, thanks Osama that you remind me that I'm old.
Yes, so
so. Old is old.
Thank you. Thank you.
So I think we are good for today. Thank you very much for attending our activity through the seventh ISN Educational Ambassadors in Africa, Dikirnis projects, and I thank you again for being too late with us, and looking forward for you tomorrow, and also in the on-site hand-on training, inshallah. Thank you for all, and have a good night and good luck.